Now we will discuss what evidence is there to support that evolution happens. And the main observation, the experimental observation of evolution, comes from artificial selection. Artificial selection is just the name we give to when humans select traits in a population. So this is, unlike natural selection, the only difference is that here are humans who are deciding which traits are going to survive and reproduce and which traits will be discarded. So for example, in this experiment, scientists looked at fruit flies, and they fruit flies have these bristles in their abdomen, and scientists selected the ones that had the highest number of bristles, and they let them interbreed with each other. They selected one that had an intermediate number and another one with a low number of bristles. And over time, as you let them interbreed and you keep selecting the ones with the higher number and the ones with the lower number, these populations will start to separate until the point where we have here, these populations have separated. So if you look, there is almost no overlap between one population and the next. So they've completely separated. As humans, we've been experimenting with artificial selection since the beginning of human settlements. For example, for growing crops, we've been manipulating crops artificially for a very long time. If you look at corn, the original corn, how it started, the original kernel was this shape, and humans selected for higher and higher number of kernels until we eventually reached the corn that we have today. Again, evidence of artificial selection can also be seen in our pets. So we've selected artificially the kinds of shapes and forms that we want and even behaviors that we want in our dogs from the original wolves. So wolves and dogs are actually not different species, and experiments have been done where wolves have been selected for friendly behavior or mellow behavior, and those just selecting for that behavior has resulted in the dogs having also different morphologies. So this is also an interesting experiment on how selecting for one trait, such as less aggression, resulted in also changes in morphology. So this shows you how certain traits are correlated with each other. Evidence for evolution also comes from the fossil record. And if we look in the fossil record, you will be able to find intermediate forms from the path of evolution. So here is the intermediate forms of whale evolution, and whales, the ancestor of whales, was a mammal that walked in land, just like many mammals today, closely related to bears, and started having a more and more aquatic life and started acquiring features more suited for aquatic environments, and slowly became the whale that we have today. Now, this is not to say that these organisms morphed, but rather over multiple generations, their offspring that had slight mutations that make them better suited for aquatic environment were more likely to survive and pass on those genes. And then their offspring, some of those had some mutations, and eventually you accumulated enough mutations to have the whales as they look today. What's interesting is that evolution is highly dependent on the environment. And if you live in the same environment, evolution will come up with similar solutions, even if you have very different evolutionary origins. So for example, fish and sharks do not share a recent common ancestor, but since they both live in the same habitat, they both have very similar morphologies that are better suited for swimming as they do. Same thing with dolphins, and these are ichthyosaurs. These are dinosaurs that colonize aquatic environments, and they also have very similar shapes, and they have a similar path of evolution in where they came from land and colonized aquatic environments. You can also see similarities between bats and extinct pterosaurs. So these are also reptiles that used to fly and had a similar niche or used a similar habitat than that of bats today. And for that reason, they have very similar traits, even though they're not related. They don't have a recent common ancestor from where they inherited those traits. Instead, these pterosaurs are reptiles, while bats are mammals. In the example here, these dolphins are mammals, and ichthyosaurs are reptiles. And bony fish are a different group from sharks, which are cartilaginous fish. We also see evidence of convergent evolution by comparing placental mammals, so these are the newest mammals, and marsupial mammals, which are mostly extinct, except for Australia, where all the mammals found in Australia belong to marsupial group. What's interesting is that you find equivalent forms between the placental mammals in North America and Europe comparing to the mammals, the marsupial mammals in Australia. So you'll find a borrower and they will look very similar in both places, even though they're not related to each other. Same thing, those who eat ants, they will have similar morphologies because they are adapting to the same habitat or the same use of the habitat, the same niche or the same feeding style, even if they're not related. So this summarizes how evolution takes genetic variation and selects those traits that are better suited to one particular environment. Therefore, evolution cannot exist without the environment or the context that it is happening. Rather, we cannot understand evolution unless we see the context in which evolution is happening.